Hello, my name is Jan Kloosterman, and in this video I will explain you the life cycle of a neutron in a nuclear reactor core. This picture explains the nuclear fission event in a nuclear reactor. When a slow neutron is absorbed by a uranium-235 atom, it adds so much binding energy to the nucleus that the uranium atom can fission in two parts, the so-called fission products. In this process, on average, 2.5 neutrons are released. In the picture I've shown 3 new neutrons. Obviously, we need only one neutron to sustain the fission chain reaction. So what happens to the rest? This I will show you later on. But first we have to explain the characteristics of fission neutrons. This plot shows the energy distribution of the 3 neutrons when they are released in a fission event. The most probable energy is the value at a peak energy, at around 700 kiloelectronvolt, while the average energy reaches a value of about 2 megaelectronvolt. Previously, you've heard about fissile nuclides, like uranium-235, which have a very high probability to fission when they absorb a thermal neutron. To enhance fission, we have to slow down the fission neutrons to energies below 1 electronvolt. Because neutrons lose a lot of energy when they collide with hydrogen atoms, water is a very good moderator. And in many reactors, the coolant acts as a neutron moderator as well. When we moderate a neutron, this means we let it collide with nuclides like hydrogen to reduce its energy, they have to travel through the energy range in which a uranium-238 has many resonances. And when a neutron has an energy in the peak of one of these resonances, the probability it will be absorbed is very high. While for other values, this probability is very low. This plot shows the processes of a neutron between its release as a free neutron and the moment it is absorbed in the reactor core or leaks away out of the reactor core. A fission neutron is released at very high energy of about 2 megaelectronvolt. And by elastic and inelastic collisions, it will lose energy and reach the resonance range of the uranium-238. Here, the neutron can lose energy via elastic collisions with the moderator, or it can be absorbed in the uranium-238 resonances. In the latter case, the neutron is lost for the chain reaction. Of course, this is also the case when a neutron leaks away from the reactor core. When the neutron survives the resonance range, it will reach the thermal energy range, and this range is very special, because the moderator atoms have an energy comparable to that of the neutrons, which means a neutron can also gain energy in a collision. But eventually, all thermal neutrons will be lost via absorption in the reactor core or via leakage out of the core. We will now follow the fission neutrons in more detail between birth and death. When the neutrons are released at high energy, some of them will be absorbed by uranium-235 or by the uranium-238. And although the chance is not very high, some of these absorption processes can lead to fission of uranium. In this case, we will gain some neutrons. And if we start with n neutrons, this number will be multiplied by the fast fission factor epsilon, which has a typical value of around 1.1. When the neutrons still have a high energy, they can escape from the reactor core. The fraction of neutrons that survives leakage is called the non-leakage probability. And because we speak here about fast neutrons, this fraction is called the fast non-leakage probability. As mentioned before, the neutrons that slow down have to cross the resonance region of the uranium-238 in the fuel. A certain fraction of the neutrons will be captured, while a fraction P, called the resonance escape probability, will survive the resonance range. The number of neutrons indicated on the right-hand side of the square have survived the resonances and will reach the thermal energy range. The thermal neutrons can disappear from the reactor core either by leakage or by absorption. The fraction that survives leakage is called the thermal non-leakage probability, indicated with the red capital P in the formula. And the remainder of the neutrons will be absorbed. However, we can distinguish between absorption by the structural materials at one side and by the fuel nuclei at the other. The fraction of the neutrons absorbed by the fuel nuclides, this is the uranium-235 and the uranium-238, is called the thermal neutralization factor. And finally, we can calculate the number of fission neutrons released when one neutron is absorbed in a fuel. And this factor is called the neutron reproduction factor. Note that this is less than the neutrons released in a fission event, because part of the neutrons absorbed in the fuel will not lead to a fission event. The neutrons absorbed by the uranium-238 will disappear without fission. We can now wrap up by calculating the ratio of the number of neutrons at the end of the neutron lifetime and the number of neutrons we started with. And this ratio is defined as the effective multiplication factor, K effective, and is given by the six-factor formula on this slide. If you would have an infinitely large reactor with no spatial leakage, the fast and thermal non-leakage probabilities would both be unity, and we would get the so-called four-factor formula, which gives an expression for the infinite multiplication factor. From the multiplication factor, we can derive another parameter that is closely related, namely reactivity. The reactivity of a nuclear reactor core is defined as a ratio of K effective minus 1 and K effective, as shown in the formula on the slide. If reactivity is larger than 0, the neutron flux increases with time. If it's less than 0, it decreases in time. Only if the reactivity is exactly equal to 0, the flux remains stationary. I want to end this video with a question for you to think over. What is the maximum theoretical value of the reactivity?